A reading of the Holy Gospel according to Matthew, the 21st chapter. Jesus said, "Listen to another parable. There was a landowner who planted a vineyard, put a fence around it, dug a wine press in it, and built a watchtower. Then he leased it to tenants and went to another country. When the harvest time had come, he sent his slaves to the tenants to collect his produce. But the tenants seized the slaves and beat one, killed another, and stoned another. Again, he sent other slaves, more than the first, and they treated them in the same way. Finally, he sent his son to them, saying, 'They will respect my son.' But when the tenants saw the son, they said to themselves, 'This is the heir, come. Let us kill him and get his inheritance.' So they seized him, threw him out of the vineyard, and killed him. Now when the owner of the vineyard comes, what will he do to those tenants?" They said to him, "He will put those wretches to a miserable death and lease the vineyard to other tenants, who will give him the produce at harvest time." Jesus said to them, "Have you never read in the scriptures, 'The stone that the builders rejected has become a cornerstone. This was the Lord's doing, and it is amazing in our eyes.' Therefore, I tell you, the kingdom of God will be taken away from you and given to a people that produces the fruits of the kingdom. The one who falls on this stone will be broken to pieces, and it will crush anyone on whom it falls." When the chief priests and the Pharisees heard his parables, they realized that he was speaking about them. They wanted to arrest him, but they feared the crowds because they regarded him as a prophet. The Gospel of the Lord.
And difficult news surrounding us.
In this little section that we heard today, Paul reveals that his greatest priority in life is the faithfulness of Christ. He wrote, "I regard everything as loss because of the surpassing value of knowing Christ Jesus, my Lord." The section grows out of early Christians wrestling with the idea of circumcision and dietary laws and the Mosaic law and the fact that Jesus came out of the Jewish tradition and yet seems to be ushering in a new practice, a new law, that law of faith. And Paul is trying to encourage them to see that faith in Christ, the righteousness of God that comes from Christ, is what we should rely on, not on our own doing. Now, Paul does start out by saying, hey, if it's on our own credentials, I have more reason to boast than anyone. Did you hear how he started it? If anyone has reason to be confident in the flesh or in the law, I have more. Circumcised on the eighth day, a member of the people of Israel, of the tribe of Benjamin, a Hebrew born to Hebrews, as to the law, a Pharisee, as to zeal, a persecutor of the church, as to righteousness under the law, blameless. Yes, he lists all his credentials, all his degrees, his doctorates, his reverence, his whatevers. But then he exposes them as false credentials when it comes to the kingdom of Jesus. What truly matters is the faithfulness of Christ, in whom we put our trust. He uses this word loss and rubbish. I count everything as rubbish. Refuse, the literal Greek word, means excrement, actually. Sorry to let you in on that, but it's clear that Paul is trying to say, I am letting go of that which has no value so that I can hold on to that which has surpassing value, Christ Jesus, my Lord. Now, in the 21st century, we might not have the same wonderings about circumcision and Mosaic law and the dietary codes as the early believers did. However, I do believe that life tempts us to put our hope, our confidence in false credentials. Whether they be material goods, or money, or success, or escapism. No, Paul reminds us, in the midst of the complexity of our lives, to have a singleness of focus, to re-examine our priorities. Did you ever hear what Confucius said so many years ago? He said, "He who chases two rabbits catches none." Reminding us of the need for singleness of focus, of examining our priorities. And for Paul, it was very clear what his priority was: the power of Jesus' resurrection. "I want to know Jesus," he wrote. Reminding us this morning of the importance of our priorities. And it's so true. Take, for example, the priority of the safety of our people. Now, this is a priority that's on my mind regularly. So when I noticed this summer that the lines on the street over here at the corner of South Wayne and Rosedale, where many of you walk across the street weekly from our grass parking lot, right there, those lines that were painted on the ground, white crosswalk lines, had faded into oblivion. You couldn't see them anymore. So we, churches in the borough, so I called the borough and said, "Hey, we'd love to have the lines repainted and, concerned about people crossing that street regularly for our services, our events." They said, "Oh, okay, well, that's at the corner, right where West Goshen meets the borough, so that's really West Goshen Township." I said, "Okay." I called West Goshen Township. I explained where we are, what I want done, and my pain and safety of the people. They say, "Oh, yeah, that's real close to the borough, so that's the borough." I was not going to give up, people. The priority before me was your safety. So I kept calling and talking and getting names and getting deeper and deeper into the woods until finally Kathy and the borough said, "Who's going to be out there taking care of them?" Sure enough, they showed up, they painted those lines, and hopefully we'll continue to have safe passages for our events. The marketers tell us what you focus on, you get more of. And isn't that what Paul is telling us this morning? The surpassing value of knowing Christ. That was his priority. That's what he was focused on. In case you haven't noticed, we've been focusing a lot on commemorating the 500th anniversary of the Reformation in these last months. Studies, parties, fundraisers, videos. It's not because we think being Lutheran is any better than any other Christian perspective, but it's because we believe that the freedom that Christ offers is worth getting out into the world. And so we're taking this opportunity of this historic anniversary to do that. Maybe you've seen the poster that says, "Watch your thoughts, because your thoughts become your words. Watch your words, because your words become your actions. Watch your actions, because your actions become your habits. Watch your habits, because your habits become your character. Watch your character, because your character becomes your destiny." Summer, a colleague friend of mine, asked, "How in the world does Calvary continue summer after summer to get 160, 170, 180 children at their vacation Bible school? Only get 30 or 40 and barely able to sustain the volunteers to make it happen." And say, we're blessed with a vibrant community. We're blessed with volunteers who step forward. We're blessed with people who make the music and the drama and the crafts and the snacks as best as they can be so that people will know Christ and the power of his resurrection. Doesn't happen without focus, without making it a priority. Paying attention to our priorities, Paul reminds us. Barbara Brown Taylor knows the importance of priorities. She's an Episcopal priest who has preached and spoken all across the country and all across the world. She talks about the importance of making loving God a priority, but not just through our prayers and worship here, but in a very practical way. She talks about how we can love God by loving people. And yet she admits how difficult that priority is sometimes. Listen to what she writes. "I have an easier time loving humankind than I do loving particular human beings. Particular human beings hug my bumper in rush hour traffic and then flip an obscene gesture when I tap my brakes. Particular human beings drop my carefully selected portobello mushrooms into the bottom of the grocery bag and then toss cans of beans on top of them. Particular human beings talk on their cell phones while I'm trying to have a nice quiet lunch. They talk on their cell phones while I'm waiting to pay them for my gas. They talk on their cell phones while I'm trying to step past them on the sidewalk. Yes, particular human beings are sometimes difficult to love. However, she says, one remedy for my condition is to pay attention to people when I can, even when they're in my way. Just for a moment, I look at the human being instead of the obstacle. That boy who's crushing my portobello mushrooms doesn't know the first thing about them. He's, what, barely 16 years old with such a bad case of acne that it must hurt when he lays his face on his pillow at night. His fingernails are bitten to the quick. He's working so hard to impress that pretty young cashier next to us, there's no wonder he doesn't see me or my mushrooms. But I see him. And just for a moment, he's more than just a bad boy. He's a child of God with his own demons, his own bad skin, his own budding love interest, his whole future ahead of him. And in that moment, I try to have a sense of reverence for his story and for God's place in it. Making a priority of loving God through loving others. Now, we don't always get it right, and isn't that the point of Paul's message? I mean, we don't get all the laws and actions perfect, and yet his confidence is in what Christ has done. Which is why I love the Vacation Bible School song that the children learned this summer. with lyrics addressed as if the author of creation was singing to you, saying, if you want to know how far my love will go, just how deep, just how wide, if you want to see just what you mean to me, look at my hands, look at my side. If I could count all the times I'd say you are forgiven, it's more than the drops in the ocean, more than the drops. No, we don't always get it right. But keeping the righteousness of God as a priority in our lives, as Paul did, keeps us moving.